How are you going to use this vehicle to improve the condition of your people?
You can't handle the truth.
At this decision, and who influenced your thinking?
I thought about it for several months. I had a chance to reflect and meditate and do a great deal of thinking about the war, and came to the conclusion then that I had no alternative but to take a vigorous stand against the war.
It's primarily a struggle for power, and I think we would be stupid indeed if we failed to see where the consequences of a supine surrender on our part would lead.
Is there something especially anti-Negro or racist about the war that impels you to speak out?
I cannot overlook the fact that I am a Negro, and that this war is doing a great deal to destroy the lives of thousands and thousands of my brothers and sisters. We are dying physically in disproportionate numbers, in some 22 and 4/10% of the deaths, even though we are only about 11% of the population. The other thing is that we are dying spiritually and psychologically in disproportionate numbers at home in the ghettos. And I think the war itself accounts for our constant spiritual and psychological death.
It's an evil war. No matter where it leads, no matter what abuses it may bring, I'm going to tell the truth.
The best way to control melanated people is keeping them poor and disenfranchised, and this is what has happened to black people in America. There's a reason why black people have been economically undermined, because it's very easy to control poor people. When people are poor, you can do whatever you want to them, and they won't have the economic power to fight back. They won't have the economic power to put a politician into power to help them out. They won't have the economic base to really take care of their basic needs, so then you can control them any way you want to.
See, white folk lend us money. They don't pay us, because they know that they're gonna get it right back.
1866. And up to about 1920s, black folk had the greatest economic achievement they've ever had in this country. Even though it didn't occur under integration, it occurred under segregation. Those black folk had managed to acquire over 20 million acres of land, according to the United States Census in 1920. 20 million acres of land. But between 1920s and 1950s, they lost almost all of it. Back in the 1920s up to the 1940s, we had black broom factories, we had black mattress factories. Almost every black major city had at least two cab companies. We had black bus companies, we had black shipyard up here in Baltimore. When I say black bus lines, I'm not talking about just having three or four buses. We had over 500 buses. And this is in Winston-Salem, North Carolina. And our bus company didn't just service just the black neighborhoods, it serviced the blacks and the white neighborhoods. We had two black cab companies. We had the Harris Cab Companies and the Campbell City Cab Companies. But they used to have their own restaurants. They had the best nightclubs in the country. The blacks had two baseball leagues. Each baseball league had eight teams. We had over 500 of the best baseball players in the world. But what did they do? They wanted to integrate. So as soon as they put Jackie Robinson on the Brooklyn Dodgers, black folks said, we'll give up all of our black baseball leagues, black teams, and all our black players, and we can just get one black boy to play on a white team.
Black Americans were gung-ho about integration because we thought that would be our passport to freedom. We equated integration with freedom.
That scared whites to death. And see, at that time, you had whites, a lot of these white separate communities. You had a Polish, you had white Polish communities, you had white Jewish communities, you had white Italian communities, you had white Irish communities. And white folks said, well, if these blacks want to integrate, we're going to come together and organize as a unit. And so white folks then dropped all their little communities and said, no, we're gonna organize as a one white block. We're not going to talk about I'm being Polish and you're Irish and German anymore. We ain't going to do that anymore. We're going to stick together as a group. We're not going to let all these blacks come and penetrate us. So black folks stripped themselves of all their resources. They stripped themselves of their unity. They stripped themselves of the role model when all blacks used to live together. Then they had their own role models. All the doctors and lawyers and teachers with the black lived all together. You had a sense of community. You knew each other. You trusted each other. You worked with each other. You participated with each other. You learned how to buy from each other, to sell each other, to support each other, to care about each other, to love each other. When black folk up into integration, blacks never locked their homes.
We practice a very profound humanity. If an Asian open a store in our community, we do not boycott and discriminate against them. If an Arab open a store in our community, we do not boycott and discriminate against them. If a Jewish person open a store in our community, we do not boycott and discriminate against them. We shop with all peoples. We treat all peoples equally. The problem is they're not treating us equally. See, we caught in our own humanity. And until we begin to address that and demand that others practice towards us the same human concern and love that we practice towards them, we will stay in this situation.
Individually, we are poor when you compare us with white society in America. We are poor. Collectively, we are richer than all the nations in the world, with the exception of nine. That's power right there, if we know how to prove it. We are putting pressure where it really hurts. We don't have to argue with anybody. We just need to go around to these stores and to these massive industries in our country. Say, God sent us by here to say to you that you're not treating his children right. We come by here to ask you to make the first item on your agenda fair treatment where God's children are concerned. Now, if you're not prepared to do that, we do have an agenda that we must follow. And our agenda calls for withdrawing economic support from you. We mean business now, and we are determined to gain our rightful place in God's world. Now, these are some practical things that we can do. We are putting pressure where it really hurts. I ask you to follow through here. We've got to give ourselves to this struggle until the end. Nothing would be more tragic than to stop at this point. We got to see it through. Either we go up together or we go down together. Let us develop a kind of dangerous unselfishness.
If white immigrants can come to this country 50 years ago with nickels and dimes and no education, and come here and pool their little nickels and dimes and no education, and set up little stores, develop these stores into larger stores, develop this into an industry which creates job opportunities for whites, we feel that with the black man spending, not setting up any businesses, not creating any industry, not creating any job opportunities for his own kind, he's not in a moral position to point the finger today at the white man and tell the white man that he's discriminating against him for not giving him a job in factories that he himself set up. And these so-called Negro leaders are such geniuses that force themselves into that which the white man has set up. They should use this same ingenuity to show the black people how to pool our wealth and set up something of our own. And then we won't have to force our way into his anymore. One more thing I would like to point out, that you can reach more people in the street who want to change than you can in the bourgeoisie society, the bourgeoisie church, and the bourgeoisie circles. Our program is directed toward the man in the street. So we spend our time in the street, and what we do with that man, instead of trying to change the white man in your mind and make you accept us, we change the mind of the black man and make him accept himself. And as soon as he accepts himself, he'll solve his own problem. He won't be trying to force himself into your factory and into your bedroom and into your kitchen.
Refused to give the Negro any land. Through an act of Congress, our government was giving away millions of acres of land in the West and the Midwest. But not only did they give the land, they built land-grant colleges with government money to teach them how to farm. Not only that, they provided county agents to further their expertise in farming. Not only that, they provided low interest rates in order that they could mechanize their farms. Not only that, today many of these people are receiving millions of dollars in federal subsidies not to farm, and they are the very people telling the black man that he ought to lift himself by his own bootstraps. Now, this is what we are faced with.
There's a direct link. Blacks won't practice group economics. Black won't practice group politics. If you don't practice, you're setting yourselves up. I told that five-story building, you're setting yourself to get wiped out. Understand the nature of race, which is economics. If you build the first floor, it's economic. Build your businesses and your industries. Control buildings and industry, and put that pools in your money, and hold that money, and practice group economics with it. Arab and Asian money bounces 12 to 13 times what it leaves. Jewish money bounces 18 times. Black folk gotta learn how to practice group economics. Black Americans spend every penny they get outside their own community. Then you take the money and the wealth that you get from that first floor and go to the second floor. The second floor is politics. You then take that money on the first floor and you control your politics. Black folk must quit allowing people to tell them to go out and vote. Vote for what? Nobody's gonna do anything for black folk in politics. Politics is controlled by money. Major corporations who got the money. That's what controls politics. If you have no money, you have no say-so, you have no benefits coming. So you take your money and you control, and you take your money from the first floor, you buy every politician on the second floor. And any politician you can't buy, you rent or lease them to get what you need. Then once you get the second floor under control with the politician, with your money, then you go to the third floor. The third floor then is the police department and the court systems. You take your money from the first floor and your politics on the second floor, and you control the court system and the police departments. Then the fourth floor, then is media. You then take the money that you generate off the first floor from business and industries, and you go after radio stations, TV stations, newspapers, and cable systems, so that you can now inform and communicate with your own people. Right now, black folk own and control less than 35 thousandths of 1% of the media in the United States. Out of 12,000 radio stations, black folk own about something like about 75 or 80. That's all. You own no cable systems. You don't have a daily newspaper. You have nothing of importance. You got about one black TV station. So you can't communicate with your people. You can't inform your people. You can't do anything. You can have Rush Limbaugh and all the rest of the guys talking about racism all day long and bad mouthing you. And O'Reilly's, they can call black folk all kind of names all day long. What are you gonna do? You can't respond. You can't even communicate with your own people because you don't have an economic base. 51% of all the prisons in the United States are black people. You know, you only make up 12% of the population. That's no accident. It's because you don't control the economics and the politics. And they're going to go after the weakest people they can get their hands on to incarcerate them. That's the black folk. And what are you going to do in response to them when they over-incarcerate you? You're going to go out and have a march, a demonstration. We're going to march. March for what? Who cares? March, they never changed anything.
I must confess that that dream that I had that day has at many points turned into a nightmare. Now the other thing that we've got to come to see now that many of us didn't see too well during the last 10 years, that is that racism
not guilty
is still alive in American society and much more widespread.
Broke his neck after Baltimore police.
A handful of protesters, a handful of criminals and thugs who...
Many in moments of anger, many in moments of deep bitterness, engage in riots. And as long as America postpones justice, we stand in the position of having these recurrences of violence and riots over and over again. Social justice and progress are the absolute guarantors of riot prevention.
Mr. Gray's death was a homicide.
The Negro was freed from the bondage of physical slavery.
The athletes marched onto a stage.
But at the same time, the nation refused to give him land to make that freedom meaningful. Freedom without land to cultivate. Freedom and famine at the same time.
And create jobs for our people.
And create jobs for
our people. The Negro is to be free. He must move down into the inner resources of his own soul and sign with a pen and ink of self-assertive manhood his own emancipation proclamation. But I want to get the language right tonight. I want to get the language so right that everybody here will cry out, yes, I'm black, I'm proud of it, I'm black and beautiful. Individually, we are poor when you compare us with white society in America. We are poor. Collectively, we are richer than all the nations in the world, with the exception of nine. That's power right there, if we know how to prove it. We begin the process of building a great economic base. And at the same time, we are putting pressure where it really hurts. We don't have to argue with anybody. We just need to go around to these stores and to these massive industries in our country, say, God sent us by here to say to you that you're not treating his children right. We come by here to ask you to make the first item on your agenda fair treatment where God's children are concerned. Now, if you're not prepared to do that, we do have an agenda that we must follow. Our agenda calls for withdrawing economic support from you. We mean business now, and we are determined.
You must know the reality of Dr. King. He's more than a dreamer. And don't you let them throw the dream speech on you from 63. Let them play for you the speech that he made in New York City when he condemned the hypocrisy of the Johnson government. Practicing violence didn't want Dr. King to preach nonviolence to us while they're training you to kill people that never did nothing to you. So, this year, we're going to redistribute some pain. Yes. Dr. King said, you don't need to talk bad. You don't need to shout. You don't need to shoot. You don't need to throw a Molotov cocktail. All we need to do is to come together in unity and use the power of our purchasing to deliver pain, and they will properly respond. So in concluding that, my brother's been so kind. He's allowed me to preach a little. He mentioned the four children that were bombed in Birmingham. My research team found words from Dr. King. After that happened, he was so hurt. He wanted all-out war. Not physical, not violent, but to shut down cities. Go out in the highway, don't let nothing move. And the one thing he really wanted to do And he knew that they weren't united enough to make it effective. And I looked at that and I said, oh, Dr. King, I didn't know that that's what he wanted.
Let them never see a black face in none of their stores. Buying their foolishness. Let black people keep their money in their pocket.
I weighed the criticisms that I would get.
Yes, sir.
I thought about even the fact that some Negroes wouldn't understand, and some respectable Negro leaders who are more concerned about being invited to the White House than invited to the cause of justice would be against me.